thank you for coming out today to this Curley Center conversation. We've got Jake Paterno here, and we're very, very happy to welcome him here. Jay is a new author, and that's the occasion of his visit with us today. He's written the Paterno Legacy, Enduring Lessons from the Life and Death of My Father, which is now in its third printing after being out for less than a month. That's right. And he's going to do us the honor of reading from it for a little while, and then what we'll do is we'll open it up to questions. The way Curley Center conversations work, if you've never been to one, is we give students the opportunity to speak first, and so we'll offer, I'll ask a few questions, and then we'll open it up to students, and then to the rest of the audience. And the event lasts about an hour, so that's what you've signed up for. I'm sure everybody here knows a little bit about Jay, but I'm just going to give you a couple of highlights. Jay coached for more than two decades in college football, with stops at Virginia, UConn, and James Madison before working for 17 years at Penn State with his father. In a variety of roles, recruiting coordinator, offensive coordinator, quarterbacks coach. During that period of time, he was honored, and the team was honored in by rankings and by statistics in numerous ways in areas that he was involved in. And he's also been recognized as an orator. His speech from his father's memorial service at the BJC was honored as was noted as one of the best speeches of the 21st century, I happened to be the editor at the Associated Press, working with a reporter who was covering it that day, and can tell you that even from someone at the time who had no Penn State connection, I would certainly agree with that assessment. So, Jay, I'll turn it over to you and let you go for it.
Okay, thank you. Everybody can hear me. This is going to be tricky now with the microphone trying to read. a couple things about the book that I want to talk about just first off. What's, I think it's important to understand this is not a Sandusky scandal book. I've done, since the book, in the last 2 months I've done somewhere more than, somewhere north of 60-something interviews as it relates to this book. And it's one thing I have to keep hitting people with is this is not a book about the Sandusky scandal. I did not want to write that book. The book did start then, when this story broke in November of 2011, 3 or 4 days into it, as we saw all the media trucks and satellite trucks and all the things on campus and saw how the story started to unfold. A friend of mine and I knew that we were in the middle of something pretty unusual and pretty big, so I started to keep notes, and I thought at that point that I would probably write a book just about that week, what it was like from the time the story broke, through my dad being fired, through the Nebraska game the next week, and originally the book was just going to be about that, and called 7 Days. As things started to unfold, I realized if I was going to write a book that had to do with Penn State, had to do with my father, it couldn't just be about that. I did not want that to be the only thing that I ever wrote about my dad. So the project, over the course of several months, and meeting with my literary agent in New York and talking about what we wanted to be, it became a book really about the lessons of my father's life. And certainly, when you write about that, you cannot leave out what happened in November of 11 and the last 2-3 months of my dad's life. Because there are lessons and values and things that he had that carried him through those 2 or 3 months. Even through the last 2 or 3 months of his life, he stayed true to the values and the things that he believed. So I hope what people get out of this book is that he was not just a football coach. That was his job, but that did not define him. He was an educator first. He was a man who simply chose football as the medium by which to paint the masterpieces of his life. And the masterpieces of his life were the lives that he changed, the lives that he impacted, the people that he reached, and the lessons that endured even though he's gone. I hope that's what people get out of this book. It's not a glossy, my dad was wonderful 24/7 book. I show some of the things he got wrong. know, he was not a perfect dad. And at the same token, I'm not afraid to show that I was far from a perfect son. But I take you in the book into the house, into funny stories, sad stories, the dinner table, into meeting rooms with coaches, into practices, into pregame locker rooms, those kind of things where most people have never seen that side of what it's all about. So what I'm going to do is read a little bit about my father at home. Let me see here. I think I'd have these memorized by now, but I don't. Okay, it's going to be tricky. When I was young, every night our family would get together for bedtime prayers. We started a little prayer that mentioned Mommy and Daddy Buttons, my parents' nickname for my oldest sister Diana, Mary Kay, Dave, Jay, and George. My younger brother Scott's name is George Scott Paterno, and we called him George then. Praying together was something we did nearly every night. Five young kids bathed, teeth brushed, dressed in pajamas, with two parents kneeling together to pray. It was truly a Norman Rockwell Americana moment. But our parents were not infallible, and as kids we were far from perfect. Being the child of a highly successful football coach in a college town is not easy. It comes with benefits, but also with negatives. For the people who would help you, there were some who resented you for the perceived easy life you got. My father always reminded us about the positives and negatives. You never get anything for nothing, he'd say. He was always trying to be fair, or appearing to be fair, with his children. He hated counters, especially if he kept score of what he'd done for one kid versus what he'd done for another. Quit worrying all the time about what someone else got, he'd say. But my father was aware that the world around us was full of scorekeepers and counters, and he was keenly aware of public perception. To that end, he did everything he could to keep us out of the public eye. He didn't want to create any resentment, and as his fame grew, he did it so that we, as his children, could do our own growing up as privately as possible. That was what he wanted us to do our own growing in private, to find our own paths. In college, I was wandering academically, unsure of what I wanted to do. In high school, I'd been able to get through to Smile to get by with A's and B's without a tremendous amount of effort. College would demand a higher effort level. Having a parent in the public eye is a very different reality. Several years ago, I caught a piece on television with actor Michael Douglas talking about being the son of Kirk Douglas. That caught my attention. Michael Douglas stated that children of highly successful parents have people who treat them differently, and it does impact the children's growth. It made a lot of sense. As we grew up at State College, there were always those people that asked, is Joe your father? And then you could see their attitude and approach to you change. Unfortunately, as a kid, I may have been aware of being treated differently, but I did not understand. If my homework was a little late, sometimes I wouldn't get dot points. If I was a little out of line, they'd let me slide. A kid subconsciously picks up on that and always expects expanded boundaries. By the time I got to college, suddenly I was trying to figure out what it was that I wanted to do with my life. Without any direction, I drifted, doing very well in some classes and poorly in others. That was what drove my father crazy. One day he gave me an article from the New York Times about a son who had finally released himself from what he perceived to be his father's expectations. It was written by Richard Lapchick, the son of former St. John's and New York Knicks head basketball coach Joe Lapchick. My father wrote a note on it for me, with the lesson being that my life and my future were up to me. I did not have to try to be him or try to do what I thought he wanted me to do. Let me go ahead to another part where I'm a little younger. Okay, it's about my dad as well. He tried his best to be a good husband. He believed that being a good husband requires knowing what you don't know. That came in handy every Christmas, Mother's Day, or Valentine's Day, which also happens to be my mother's birthday. Once my sisters reached high school, my father figured out that they could pick out gifts for my mother far more effectively than he could. He did shop for her in the early days. When we were young, he took the four oldest children to a store on Allen Street. We walked into the old Bostonian store, and my father, with the help of Guy Kresge, one of the owners, picked some boots and purse and gloves. There were three boxes wrapped up for my mom, but all four of us wanted to take a box home, and my father was stuck trying to get out of there without one child crying. So the owner gave him an empty box for us to take home. My mom was excited to see four boxes under the tree. She was surprised to open an empty box and ultimately laughed at my father's attempt shopping with the four kids. Later in life, my sister Mary Kay ran point on my father's gift shopping for my mother. In recalling her duty as a loving daughter, she said, "Dad always thought about getting Mom something, but could never get downtown to shop for her because he was hounded by people talking to him. I started asking him if he wanted me to shop for him. I showed him the gifts before they were wrapped so he could at least pretend he picked them out. It was always a game. Mom would say, 'What is it?' before she opened it. But then after she did, he'd always say, 'I thought you'd really like that.' Actually, in 2011, he walked down and purchased cards for their anniversary. He always felt he owed my mother the best of everything he could do for her because she meant so much to him. Throughout his career, he could focus on his job, knowing she had the home front secure. But there were times when he had to watch us, and most of the time, no one got hurt. On occasion, there were disastrous moments. When we were very young, my mother went to Mass alone, leaving my father in charge of four young kids. Dave was about 4 years old, my little brother. He cut his head. My father could not find the bandages. So my sisters, aged 8 and 6, looked for some in my mother's bathroom cabinet. What they found were feminine hygiene products. So as my father pulled up outside the church, Dave was hanging out the window with a maxi pad on his head. My mother was justifiably mortified. As she got in the car, she looked at my dad in disbelief. She asked why there was a maxi pad on her son's head, and my father replied that he couldn't find the band-aids. Then she asked why he didn't take the maxi pad off their son's head. "I'm not touching those things," he said. It was just part of who he was. There were some things he couldn't and wouldn't deal with. That was one of the minor incidents. Dave broke his arm as a young kid after jumping off the fireplace ledge. There was my sister Mary's broken hip when she was just out of college. There was a whole series of accidents that my mother had, and every time he was by her side through it all. The worst is when my mother broke her hip in Spain. My father was across the Atlantic and did not speak Spanish, so he called home to get help from his children. Mary swung into action, and along with my father's staff assistant, Cheryl Norman and Sandy Sigursky, they arranged to get a way home for my mother and father, and even to get a Spanish speaker on the phone with the doctor. As they were leaving Spain to get home to have the surgery done here, my father offered the doctor cash to pay for the help he'd given them. Through an interpreter, the doctor told my father there was no charge here in this country. We may not have much money, but we are not poor. Through that event, we saw my father rely on his children and then remain by my mother's side after surgery and through the recovery in Hershey, Pennsylvania until she was ready to come home. Seeing my father by my mother's side in those days reminded me I had grown up in a home with two parents who loved each other. Let me read a little football for you. Now this chapter is called "It's Gotta Be the Shoes." On Penn State's game days, Joe Paterno's black shoes were almost as iconic as his dark glasses. The same went for his team's plain uniforms and footwear. Every game, the black Nike shoes seemed to sparkle in the autumn sunlight like they'd just been polished. There was good reason for that. They had. As kids, my brother Dave and I would alternate polishing my father's dress shoes. My mother wasn't too excited about this because she feared we'd ruin our clothes with shoe polish. But she relented and got us a wooden shoe shine box where we kept the polish, rags, and brushes. One spring day, my father offered me 50 cents to shine his shoes. A lot of money back then. I'm not that old, but that was a lot of money. It's enough for two packs of newly arrived baseball cards at the College Heights Exxon. Anxious to get paid and walk to the gas station, I did a shoddy job on his shoes. I wanted to be the first to score the coveted Reggie Jackson card. Trusting them I had done the job correctly, my father paid me before he saw the results of my half-hearted work. Upon my return, I was lectured about taking pride in everything that I did. In my haste, I failed to actually earn the money I had received. There is karma in this world. Reggie Jackson was not in the pack. As I sat in the basement laundry room all alone, it was a sad, solitary moment. I sat with my guilt while hearing the sound of a metal zipper clanging as it tumbled in the dryer. I repolished the shoes to meet his standard. Standards mattered. Every time he went to make a speech or meet a recruit's family, he'd do everything he could to make a great first impression. Jay, he said, "If you don't shine them right, they won't look right." "So what?" I said. "Look, people will judge you. If your shoes are sloppy, it's a sign you don't care about every detail. If you care enough that even your shoes are polished, they'll see it. 8 years later, I'd learn even more about the shoes. In my freshman year on Penn State's team, we were approaching the season opener. After Thursday's practice, we were all told to bring our shoes up to the equipment room. I asked why. Assistant equipment manager Brad Spider Caldwell pulled me aside to tell me about the shoes. "Jay, we polish them up every Thursday before the game," Spider said. Looking around the room, I saw the student manager spread out with black shoe polish working on piles of cleats. The smell of polish in the air highlighted the intensity of their work. "Why?" I asked. "Tradition," Spider replied. Tradition. As a student of the game of football, I just loved that word. It evoked memories of Penn State Heisman Trophy winner John Cappelletti banging through the line of scrimmage into the end zone when I was 5 years old. That was the year I got hooked on tradition. Tradition can't be manufactured instantly. Tradition is excellence over time, a gift and a challenge. In 1986, Penn State's black shoes were tradition, but also a rarity among the vast majority of teams wearing white shoes. Our conservative adherence to the black shoes of our ancestors' days was widely ridiculed. It was seen as a sign of Joe Paterno's failure, or worse yet, refusal to keep up with the latest fads. They may have been right. Joe loved to swim against the tides. Like all great traditions, there's a story behind the shoes and uniform. In high school, my father's coach took him to a World Series game between the St. Louis Cardinals and the New York Yankees. The Cardinals came out with scuffed shoes and sloppy uniforms. The Yankees emerged in crisp uniforms and something else, which my father's coach pointed out to him. "Look at the Yankees' shoes," the coach said. There was a smile in my father's eyes 50 years later as he described the Yankees' black shoes shining in the sun. They were immaculately polished. "Jay," my father said, "my coach wanted me to see the Yankees' professionalism while the Cardinals looked like bums." "Who won that World Series?" I asked. "Who do you think?" "The Yankees, and the image was set," he said. "But you weren't a Yankees fan, though." "I was a Dodger fan. I hated the Yankees, but I respected their tradition." Tradition, I love that word. Yankee tradition reminded me of my youth listening on the radio after bedtime to Mr. October ripping another World Series home run. Respect for tradition was something that was part of our upbringing in a paternal household, but the tradition went beyond cleats. The Yankees' ideal reached beyond shoes. The Yankees have no names on their jerseys. They require their players to shave, keep their hair cut, and don't allow earrings on the field. Anyone familiar with Joe Paterno's Penn State teams recalls those traditions. The shoes were just one sign. The jerseys were another, but ultimately the whole package represented what Joe Paterno wanted for Penn State student athletes. He sold this idea. Penn State is not for everyone. In recruiting, he wanted students to come to Penn State for the right reasons. Being part of Penn State's football was a privilege, requiring everyone to give something up for the group. Isn't that how everything worthwhile in life works? That was his life lesson. We wanted to be different, and we asked our players to be different. It wasn't without issues over time. In the late 1960s, Franco Harris had a mustache when he arrived at Penn State. The staff complained that team rules forbade facial hair and that Joe should do something about it. Joe asked, "Did anyone tell him the rules when we recruited him?" When it became apparent that no one had informed Franco, Joe allowed Franco to have his mustache because no one had told him. In the early 2000s, the haircut rule became an issue with some of the black players in the team who wanted braids or dreads. Joe called a team meeting to explain that everyone, regardless of race, had to cut their hair, but he went further. He pointed that Stanley O'Neill, the CEO of Merrill Lynch and a black man, was running one of Wall Street's most prestigious firms. He talked about Ken Chenault, CEO of American Express, only the third African-American CEO of a Fortune 500 company. He wanted the student athletes to consider if O'Neill and Chenault would be CEOs if they had braids. Then he pointed out President George W. Bush's hair. He asked if they believed he would be President of the United States if he had a ponytail. Then he compared the CEO's higher compensation with that of an NFL player and noted the lifelong earning potential of a business executive versus the 4 or 8 year NFL career. He understood the unfairness of people judging others by haircuts or by looks, but it was how the real world worked. Joe Paterno wanted his student athletes to have an understanding of the reality that awaited them, a world that judged everything. Before the 2005 season, Joe decided to get tougher on all the rules about personal appearance. In a staff meeting, we talked about the rule, and the biggest offender was Tom Bahali, an outstanding defensive end. Joe asked if Tampa had been told when he was recruited that he would have to cut his hair. As with Franco Harris 40 years earlier, it turned out Tampa had never been told. In the team meeting, Joe told everyone to cut their hair. Everyone explained except Tom Bahali, because no one had ever warned him before he came to Penn State. Joe assumed everyone else had been told, but did ask anyone else who'd not been told the rules before they got to Penn State to raise their hands. Not one hand went up. At the very next team meeting, when the team filed in, it seemed all the haircuts were in order. To Joe's pleasant surprise, about three rows from him sat Tom Bahali with a wide grin on his face and his head shaved. The day he died, Joe would have gone to war for Tom Bahali because of that show of respect to Penn State's tradition. A tradition was born in the 1940s to a wide-eyed high school kid from Brooklyn watching the greatest baseball teams in the world battle for a championship. 60 years later, he reminded this Red Boston Red Sox fan that free agents signed with Boston because they offered the biggest contract without having to make any personal sacrifices to play there. To be a Yankee, a part of the greatest organization in baseball, is not a right. It's a privilege. It requires the best players in the world to give something up to play for them. That is all Joe wanted from his student athletes, an outward sign of shared adherence to a standard. The signs showed each other and those outside the program that being at Penn State was special, that common sacrifice would make it tougher for them to let each other down. It all started with polished shoes in baseball's fall classic and gave birth to a fall classic Penn State football tradition. What made Joe Paterno's Penn State tradition so special? It's got to be the shoes, but it is so much more. On that note, done my reading, so I've proven that I can read, and I'll open up for questions. Although my wife was going to come, but when she found out it was John Affleck and not Ben Affleck, she
opted out. I get that a lot. Usually people think I'm related to
John DeArco, by the way.
So my first question is just background here for people who aren't familiar with the Curley Center. I teach sports writing, I also teach news media ethics, and I have a couple of questions for Jay related to those classes. First, for sports writing, you dedicated the book to student journalists. And I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit about why and your experience with journalists and what you feel young people have to learn at this stage.
Well, I think right now journalism is in a very, very interesting, really kind of juncture as to which way it goes. When you look at the coverage of some of the biggest stories, and obviously what happened here is one of them. When you look at the way the Ray Rice story is being covered and the way that the Jameis Winston gets suspended last week for a game for yelling two words that I've yelled, and I would guarantee every journalist that's covered him has yelled at some point. And obviously Jameis Winston had some other things that he'd done, but he was suspended simply because he said something in a public place while hanging out with his friends. It was tweeted, picked up, story was covered. Next thing you know, he's suspended for a game. So where does the on-the-record, off-the-record end? There's a lot of challenges, but one of the things I think is important is the pressures in journalism now. The business model of the for-profit media rewards being first over being right. And you dedicated the book in part to students studying journalism with the hope that they would understand that when you get things wrong, it has real-world consequences for real people. It changes destinies. And what I hope people will do is look in their hearts as they cover stories from now on and get it right and understand telling the truth and getting it right is the most solemn responsibility we have in freedom of the press without question. So that's why I dedicated, that's why I hope people will read that and learn and understand those things.
Were there particular experiences with particular journalists? I'm not trying to get you to start a fight with somebody, but particular journalists who stand out in your memory any time during your career, but through that period, who were fair, who were or were particularly difficult to deal with?
Oh, geez, let's see. Well, in the book, I mentioned Christine Brennan from USA Today because she made some very, very tough comments and things about Joe, and when facts started to come out that contradicted what she had said, a guy interviewing her brought those up, and she said, "I already know everything I need to know." And to me, that's bad journalism. You need to constantly reevaluate. And on the flip side, you've got like Bob Costas, who the day after the Free Report came out, or 3 or 4 days, was on Meet the Press saying, and said Penn State should shut their football program down. He said that he should get the death penalty, all these kind of things, and he had not read the Free Report. And when he started to read, when he went back and read the Free Report, he's done many interviews, and has backtracked and said, "Look, I didn't read it before I made those statements." He's been very, very fair. In fact, he was in an interview with Feinstein recently, and John Feinstein made a comment about the NFL situation was much like the Joe Paterno Penn State situation, where they were just trying to protect the brand. And Bob Costas interrupted him and said, "I can't let that comment go without getting into it." And he spent the next 7-8 minutes of the interview correcting the misperceptions that Feinstein had, because he had read the report and gone back and looked at it and realized it was wrong. So I give him a lot of credit, because that's what good journalism should be. If you get the story not 100% right, don't be afraid to go get the facts and get it right. And it's never too late to get it right.
Great. Let me just talk. You have a chapter, I think it's the first chapter, that's called The Elephant in the Room. And I hear you when you say it's not a Sandusky book. It very much is not. But I do want to address one thing that you address in the book very much head on, which is essentially what came up the Monday following the indictment, when the head of the state police basically said, "Your father did what was legally expected of him, but he didn't do his moral duty in reporting the McCreary incident." One of the things we talk about in news media ethics is that what's legal may not be everything that you are morally obligated to do. And you address that in the book. I'm wondering if you can talk about that now.
Yeah, I think one of the things that, you know, at the time it was, that became the headline. Mm-hmm. The headline wasn't that Jerry was charged. The headline wasn't that Tim Curley and Gary Schultz at the time were facing charges. It was that Joe had failed his moral obligation. Now, that's a judgment call on his part. But when you look at what the law requires, the moral obligation is to follow the law, because in these types of crimes, you can't do more than report it, simply because you run the risk of ruining the integrity of the investigation. Over the years, people have done interviews, people say, "Why didn't he call Jerry Sandusky?" Well, if you call Jerry Sandusky, you tip him off and something's up. He could destroy evidence, or he could contact the victim and say, "Keep your mouth shut." If you go outside the chain of command, you could alert people that then alert the accused. But you also have to protect the identity of the accuser. That's very important in these types of crimes, whether it's child sexual abuse or whether it's sexual assault or rape allegations. The accuser's identity has to be protected, so you have to follow us. Less than a month ago, just to give everybody just a little bit of an aside, but less than a month ago, the NCAA came out and issued guidelines as to how sexual assault allegations committed by student athletes and sexual assault allegations committed by staff members of athletic departments should be handled. And they are 2AT, exactly what Joe Paterno did, exactly what Penn State did. You're to report them outside the athletics department. You're not to try and direct an investigation, not to try and conduct your own investigation, and not to go outside the chain of command. So, and that was formulated, according to the NCAA, over the last 3 or 4 years. So clearly, you know, they punished Penn State for doing exactly what they're advocating everybody does now. So, and the moral component and the legal component as relates to these types of investigation are to be intertwined. Mm-hmm.
It's nice. That's a nice segue to the NCAA. We're, you know, it's homecoming weekend. It's a happier homecoming weekend for Penn State. We're now in a position where the university can, or the football team can play in a bowl. We're competing for the Big Ten championship, unbeaten. To what extent, after everything you've been through, can you sort of do you feel any sort of enjoyment, or is it gratifying to see the sanctions lifted for you? What was your reaction when they were taken back, when the NCAA retrenched?
Very happy, but I think one of the things that we have to all understand is that is there is still more to do. And it's not simply just to get records back or things like that. Yeah, the NCAA has to acknowledge. Now, they lifted the bowl ban and they lifted the scholarship by hiding behind the Mitchell report, rather than admitting that the sanctions were never warranted in the first place. And that, to me, is the most important thing, is that they own up the fact they got it wrong. Because, you know, I know the games. I saw the games. You know, I know what happened. You can't take it away from me. But at some point, we'll all be gone. I think it's important that the history of this university, the history of this program across the board in athletics is recorded accurately. Because I've said, if I've said it once, I've said it hundreds of times in the last 8 months, those aren't Joe's wins. He'd be the first one to tell you. They belong to the student athletes. They belong to professors who didn't commit academic fraud. They belong to administration that supported a program that compelled our players to compete at the highest level on and off the field in every sport. Every sport. And it belongs to the alums who didn't buy players. You know, there were times when people would say, hey, you want us to help you get this guy? And you say, no, we don't do that. Oh, that's right, we don't do that. So, I mean, there's a lot of people, those wins belong to so many people. They belong to students that were part of that. So as far as I'm concerned, you know, it's time for the NCAA to own the fact that these sanctions were not warranted, that it was an overreach, and that we did not have a football culture problem. We did not have an integrity problem at Penn State, never did. And to me, I think that's the end result of this. Not necessarily that we'll have a statue put back up or wins restored, those kind of things. We want them to finally acknowledge they got it wrong.
On that note, let's just open it up to students first. Does anybody have a question for Jay? You're all on.
I'll run out of ladies first. Go ahead.
Has writing always been, has it been a hobby or an interest, or how did you go from football coach to author?
That's a good question. No, I've always written things. One of my last semesters at Penn State, I wrote a comic for a collegiate every 2 weeks. I wasn't very good, but you know, I've always written, and even when I was coaching, you know, where some people have hobbies, you know, some people play video games, some people, you know, have other hobbies. You know, they golf for 4 hours or whatever. I would write. So, I've already got another book started that's well down the tracks. I've got a bunch of short stories that I've already written, and we'll see if they go anywhere. So it's something that I've always done. I didn't think this would be the first book I wrote about something like this, but it's you know, it's just, I guess I can say this because everybody here is 18 above. My wife said, you've always been full of bullshit, so you may as well write fiction. So there's some fiction in me somewhere, but no, it's something I've always done.
As someone who's been on both sides of the spectrum now as a coach and a writer, is there anything that one has taught to the other in your experience?
Well, I think the thing that was surprising to my publisher and to my literary agent is when they gave me a deadline, I was always early. And they said, well, gee, we're not used to authors actually turning stuff in on time. And I said, well, you understand, you know, from coaching, you know, if the kickoff is 3 o'clock on Saturday afternoon, you better be ready. And you better have it done, and you better have everything prepared. So you get used to that kind of, you know, here's the next thing, or practice is tomorrow, we get ready for practice, or I got to go see this recruit. So you're used to being on a regimented schedule that way. So I think that was one of the things that helped me with the writing. Because if you don't have a hard and fast deadline, it's very easy to kind of let a project sit, and then you don't get back to it. And then before you know it, you have to reread it to understand What was I trying to get at? Where was this headed? So I think the coaching part of it really kind of forced me to really be on time. And really what ended up happening was, because I got the manuscript in done in early, it went to the publisher early, who then shipped it out early, and then Barnes & Noble State College got it early, and they put it out early, like 6 weeks early, which caught me completely by surprise. And next thing you know, 3 or 4 days later, we started literally just a steady march of media, starting with Colin Cowherd and Doug Gottlieb and all that, all the way through. I just did one today. I've got, I think, one or two tomorrow. I've got 7 or 8 lined up next week. So I mean, it's just continuing. It's been 2 or 3 straight months of this, but that's one of the things that kind of helped me. As far as the writing goes, there were times where, you know, if you were working on a game plan and And sometimes you hit a wall, just like you get writer's block, and you're, how do I get, how do we handle, you know, and then your creativity gets stifled, or you're in a different place. Sometimes I pull out a pen and paper and just write, freeform write. Or I get on a computer and just freeform write whatever came out of my head, and then it would unclog kind of creativity that I may have had and allow me to coach some more. And to design plays, things like that, diagram things, come up with game plans and stuff. So they kind of fed off each other.
How about the research end of it? You're chronicling such a long period of time. How did you develop the materials at all, from memory, or did family records, did you keep notes through the most turbulent periods?
Well, through the most turbulent periods, I kept a lot of notes. And then a lot of the football stuff were files that I had. Football coaches are terrible, whatever. We do everything on paper, and then we put it in files, and you always find the cameras. And there's a lot of things that were my dad's notes that I went through and found things. As this story broke and the tweets started to come, I mean, one of the things I put in some in the book is there are a lot of tweets that I got from people that are, some of them are beautiful, and there's emails I got that are beautiful and letters I got that are beautiful, and then I juxtaposition them. Right below them, I put something that you literally cannot believe I'm asking people to be, but I kept them all just so that I would have a running record of the emotions of the time. So yeah, we the research part of it was not hard because I just had access to all that stuff. And one thing I did in this book is I didn't really ever put myself somewhere where I wasn't. So the night my dad was fired, I didn't write about what the trustees did that night because I wasn't there. And anything I would write, you run the risk of not being accurate because you're asking other people for the recollection. So all I did was write about what I went through that night and my feelings that night. And so I kept it pretty much into mostly the things that I was there for.
Let's open it up to everybody. Anybody got a question for Jay?
What's that next book? You said you got one coming up.
The next book is... I don't know if you guys are familiar with the book Primary Colors, which is really ostensibly a chronicle of a fiction, non-fiction chronicling of the Clinton campaign in 92 when he ran for president. And what this book would essentially be would be a college football version of that, where I'm going to take a coach, basically going to be a year in the life of a coach on the hot seat, and take you through what it's like right after that coach loses a big bowl game. And the next year, through the recruiting, through agents coming after the players, through a couple of his players getting in trouble with the law, through big games and the pressures that are on. The book opens with the president of the university showing up at a hotel room at the bowl game the morning after a loss, a bad loss, and basically saying, look, I can't hold off some of these donors very much longer. You've got to give me something to work with, or this is it. So it's really the pressure on the assistant coaches, the pressure on the families, the pressure on the players, what players are dealing with now compared to what they were 15 years ago in terms of a celebrity status. I mean, Jameis Winston's a household name. Johnny Manziel was a household name. They were Heisman Trophy winners as freshmen. That changes their whole life because of social media, because of all the things around it. It's just the way it goes. That's how it is. And the pressure that are on those guys now, if they chronicled everything I did or my teammates did when we were in college, these guys might look pretty sane compared to what some of the things I saw. Not that we were that bad, but I mean, if you tweeted everything we did in college, I don't think any of us would be, we'd all be in jail probably. Okay, maybe I shouldn't go that far, but the point is, there are things that now become stories. That would never have been stories 20 years ago. When I was in college, in the collegian on Monday, everybody would get the collegian on Monday to see who got arrested for public urination. That was a big story. Like, wow, okay. Oh, I know that guy, and this guy got a public urination. But there was a little police report in the collegian. And that's as far as it went. And even if it was a football player, that's as far as it went. Or even if it's a prominent person, that's as far as it went. Now, if a football player gets a public drunkenness charge, it's an AP story. It gets picked up, it goes all over the country, it's on ESPN.com, and all of a sudden, Joe Smith, the quarterback at wherever, is now a bad kid, he's a criminal, he's a drunk. And those are the pressures I think I want to get across in this book for people to see. I think it's going to be interesting. You know, there's going to be a lot of true stories. Some of the recruiting stuff will surprise people of what really goes on. And I'm talking in this day and age, bags of $50,000 cash and showing up. I mean, that goes on more than you would even imagine. But it's going to be fun to write about this. Any questions?
So the new book, is that about a fictional coach or a coach you know intimately?
No, it's about a fictional coach. It's about a fictional coach. And I think right now I'll pick a school and use it because I don't want to make up a fake school. You know, I want to have some reality. But I'm about 40,000 words into it and probably about 120,000 words long before I'm all done. But I think it's going to be an interesting look behind college football for people. And there'll be some things that are like black eyes that people look at and say, wow, I didn't realize football was that bad. And then there'll be some things that are positive, you know, that aren't necessarily black eyes on the, you know, on the sport. There'll be some things that are positive about it.
Just let me just jump in for 1 second. A little bit heavier question. One of the things, when your father was very ill, he wrote, maybe the silver lining of everything that has happened in these past months is that people will focus more on sexual assault and those kinds of problems. Do you sense that has happened in the wake of all of this, that America in general has become more aware of the problem?
I think this community has. I think there's no question this community has. I'm not sure it's resonated beyond here or not. But I definitely know it has definitely had a major impact here in Newport. Because I still run into it when I do interviews with national media or people that are further away. They still want to push back on some of the things that we all know now to be true, that this can happen anywhere. That this isn't, this happens, not can happen, it does happen everywhere. It happens in every community in America. And in some of the work we did with a guy like Jim Clemente, who was, before he left the FBI, was one of the top FBI profilers in these types of crimes. You know, he's, Jay, I put hundreds of guys away like this. These people that were former FBI agents that started youth soccer leagues and abused hundreds of kids in the youth soccer league. And one, you know, he said, I'm telling you, this is not unique to your community. And so I think it's raising some awareness. I hope it continues to do so. But, you know, I hope it resonates a little further than just beyond this community, this state.
You know that earlier that this is not like a Derek Sandusky scandal book, but did the victims of the scandal have any influence on the way you book the book? And not in regards to the football aspect, but your father's morals and stuff like that. Did it have any influence on how you were writing things?
Well, a little bit in terms of I wanted to make sure that I didn't write anything that would offend anybody in regard or reopen any old wounds for any of them. So I really stayed away from the specifics per se of, I don't get into victim one said this, victim two said this, victim, I don't get into that. Because again, I wasn't there. I wasn't, you know, I didn't go to Jerry's trial and watch all that thing. So I stay away from that. And I really just focus on the fact that when at the end of the day, when you look at, and then part of that chapter that we talked about, the elephant in the room, it's the defense of Penn State as well as the defense of Joe Paterno. One of the things I wanted to get across to people, and I continually try to get across to people, is this is not a Penn State scandal. And every time I see Penn State scandal, I cringe because it's not. It's a Jerry Sandusky issue, not Penn State. And the vast majority of the things that happened as it related to Jerry Sandusky, absolutely nothing to do with Penn State, did not happen on Penn State's campus. And so as a result, Penn State has been cast as bearing the responsibility for all this when they really aren't. One man was. And there are people that do these kinds of things that work on almost every campus in America. So I want to be sensitive to those things, but also want to make sure at least we addressed the facts as they relate to Penn State and my dad in this case. It's a good question, I'm very good. Go ahead.
You were talking earlier about how much you appreciate seeing the Yankees uniforms. When you turn on the TV on Saturdays, you see the names on the jerseys or not running the ball on second down. Is that like kind of cringe
Hey, we threw the ball a lot on second down, so don't. In fact, I'll give you a stat. You know, in 1982, which is a long time before you were born, Penn State was the first team to win the national championship throwing for more yardage in the season than they ran for. Okay, first team ever to do that. Okay, so when we got the guys, we threw it. You know, in 2008, when we had Darrell Clark and we had spread HD offense, we were up and down the field throwing the ball. I mean, there were times that Joe would come down and say, you throw it every down for a while. You know, you can mix in a run here and never throw it every down because they're playing the run. But the names of the jerseys, yeah, I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, a lot of former players, because they feel very strongly about it. But again, it's not my call anymore. It's the current guy's call, and that's up to them. And if that's what they want to do, that's what they want to do. So I can do anything about it. I can't get mad about it, you know. But it does look weird. It looks really strange. But that said, if I had my choice, I'd take the Big Ten logo off the front first, because they've done nothing for us through this whole issue. In fact, they pile on. And even when we got the bowl ban lifted, Delaney says, I'm not going to give Penn State the money, because I think he's already told everybody, you know, these other schools in the league, this money's yours, and I think they've already spent it. Really, I do. So I would take the Big Ten off the front of it, because they've never done us any favors, ever. So that to me is more offensive than the names in the back.
Yes, directing your attention to your father's vision, and one I believe you share with respect to collegiate football, I wonder if you might have a view of the future of the student athlete. And the things that concern me, or at least direct that to my attention, is the team that's coming here this weekend was recently informed it could form a collective bargaining group. A couple of months ago, there was a case by EA where EA and the NCAA lost, and now student athletes can perhaps exploit their images up to $5,000. Let's talk about paying student athletes compensation as employees. I wonder, what do you think this does to your father's vision, your vision of the student athlete? Will we have student athletes?
Well, a couple things. I think the first thing is the NCAA and the powers that be at these schools have brought this on themselves. They have gotten absolutely ridiculously greedy. Contracts are too big. The money is too big. They're building television networks. I mean, why we're in the same conference as Nebraska, and that's no offense to Nebraska, but what does Rutgers have in common with Nebraska? It's not a regional rivalry. It's not there's no crossover. You know, I mean, I think every Penn State that went out to New Jersey to see the Rutgers game, you realize how much they hate us. And have hated us for a long time, because we never lost. I mean, we always beat them. But we're really creating things. We're creating television networks that put on programming. That's why attendance is down across the board. Student attendance nationally is down 7.98%. Now, Penn State sells out their student tickets, but that student section hasn't been full in the last 3 years. Even last year in Michigan, top section is not full. I think we're reaching the point where there's a disconnect, because it's about money. And everybody knows it's about money. And I think that is when we're going to get into a dangerous area as it relates to the future of college sports, because the NCAA March Madness, 14-year television deal, $10.8 billion. Now, why wouldn't a student athlete say, hey, I want some of that? You know, coaches make, you know, the average coaching salary in college football is somewhere around $3 million right now. And the average coach in 1A football has only been in school less than 3.5 years. So coaches can jump around whenever they want. They can trade up for the next biggest paycheck. They can go here, they can go there. So student athletes are starting to say, well, if it's good for you, why isn't it good for me? And I understand the argument. And I'm an idealist. I would like to see college sports stay as amateur as possible. So I think it's going to take some very visionary leadership the next 3 or 4 or 5 years to steer this thing forward in a way that still makes it a college sport. Because the minute, you know, one thing that these players are going to find out, the minute they're getting paid, the way people look at them and the way people treat them in the stadium when they don't do well, it's going to change drastically. It's going to change drastically if they're no longer really a student athlete. And that can change now, even with technology. There are schools where their players are taking 12 credits all online. They're never even setting foot in the classroom. So they're not even really students at that university. And God only knows who's sitting in front of the computer taking those 12 credits. So, you know, that, you know, we're in a very, very interesting time. It's going to take visionary leadership, but I don't see, I think it goes without saying, I don't see visionary leadership at the head of the NCAA right now. I think he's established the fact that, you know, we don't find him a visionary. But I'm very concerned about the future, and that's one of the reasons I thought I might never get back into coaching, one of the reasons I'm thinking about it, because I think it's important that we get people back in this game that are here for the right reason, not because they can get the next big paycheck. The people that want to have kids that compete at the highest level in the classroom on the field, and I hope that remains the case at Penn State, I really do. I think it will. But I certainly think we need more people like that in this business.
Sounds like a good book for you, too.
Well, I mean, that's part of what I'm doing in the next book. Any other questions?
I was just wondering, what are your thoughts regarding like reporters or analysts or fans that say, you know, we're already two coaches past Paterno. We need to move away from, you know, like this tradition, like with the jerseys and how they're playing and like all the traditions that he's in. So can we even move past that, or is he always going to be there?
Well, I'll say this to you. I think one of the things people, in the hyperkinetic world we have in the media, what people do not get about college football, and it's not Penn State alone, what people do not understand about college football is all about tradition. Okay, all about tradition. At Texas, there are certain traditions. At Alabama, there are certain traditions. At Michigan, as much as we may dislike them, there's traditions. Ohio State, there are certain traditions that they have. Suddenly, Urban Meyer tomorrow said, we're taking the Buckeyes off the helmet, it would be a shock to everybody's system. If suddenly Urban Meyer said, we're not going to talk about Woody Hayes ever again here, it would be a shock to the system. If you go down to Alabama, you see houndstooth hats, which is what Bryant wore. You see women wearing houndstooth skirts, which is, you know, a playoff of Bryant's hat. And that's not that we have to sit here and talk about Joe Paterno 24/7. That's not what I'm getting at. What I'm getting at is those are your traditions. And that's what roots people. There's a reason that a program like Miami can struggle now, despite where they're located, because they're playing in a stadium that's not theirs. They're playing 30 miles from your campus. They're playing in a stadium that no player that's played there remembers playing. They've kind of torn themselves away from their traditions. And I think one of the things that will happen here eventually is we'll re-embrace that tradition, not because of Joe Paterno, but because of what we're all about. And people want to be able to celebrate everything that they saw and feel good about everything they saw. And that's going to come back. I mean, the NCAA is going to lose. It's just the end of story. Okay, we had some great rulings in our favor. A week and a half ago as it relates to the lawsuit. Tremendous rulings in our favor. They put a lot of pressure on us. We're going to win. No question about that, because we've got the truth on our side and we've got a better team. But no, I think it's not just unique to this place. You know, when John McAfee went to the University of Texas, he took down everything in the building that had to do with their tradition and said, well, nothing here before matters. And he didn't last very long. When Mack Brown got to Texas, he said, put everything back up. That's part of what we sell. That's part of what makes us unique, is that we have these Heisman trophies. We have Darryl Royal in our country. And that's the thing I think that makes each university program unique. Nick Saban has been great in terms of that. And not that I think everybody's got to talk about this, and not necessarily about Bryant, but what the fans get. You know, fans continue to come back to Penn State because it's what they've always done. Not because of Joe Paterno, because this is home. This is part of their genetics, part of their DNA. So I think we'll re-embrace that, and you start to see it. Now that with the bowl bands lifted, you're starting to see us, you know, people get more excited. And I'm very, very happy about that. Any questions?
Was there any specific part in the book that was particularly difficult for you to write? And if there was, how did you get through that as a writer?
There were two sections probably the toughest to write. One was the last day and a half, 2 days of my dad's life. And it is very, very, I mean, I take you right into that room. And it's very emotional to read. And it was very, very emotional to write. And that was difficult. But I wanted to write it. Because even up to the last moments of his life, he was the same guy. He wasn't bitter. He wasn't mad. He was aware of everything that was going on. And he went on his own terms. You know, he went on his own terms. You know, we discussed putting him on a morphine drip and taking him off the ventilator and all that kind of stuff. And he went, he, when, morning when all the five kids, all of his kids were in the room, and my mom was in the room, and he just slipped away. Without having to be taken off the ventilator, without having to go on a morphine, you're completely cognizant of what was going on. And because I think deep down he did not want to make my mom make that decision and then regret it the rest of her life. Well, maybe if I had just kept him on another day or two. The other part that was tough to write was really a section called, a chapter called Where Exactly Is Rock Bottom? Where it takes you from right after the Nebraska game all the way through the free report, and how it just kept, when you thought you hit rock bottom, something else would come out, and then something else would come out. And all these things that were happening, and all the emails and tweets and anonymous letters and things that I got were brutal. I mean, the day my dad dies, someone tweets to me, thank God Joe Paterno's dead, now he can't rape any more children. I mean, those are the kind of things we're talking about. I mean, nasty stuff. Even to the point where I, you know, in February of 2013, received multiple death threats. And police showed up at my house, and they found some of the people that had made them. So, I mean, I get into it, and that was tough to write. It's tough to write and talk about. And, but I wanted to write it. I wanted to understand that through all that, the things I learned from carried me through those things. That even in the most difficult days of my life, hopefully the most difficult days of my life at this point, hopefully it doesn't get any worse, that what he taught me carried me through those things.
Take one more and then we'll...
Yeah. Go ahead.
During that time period, did you try to read everything that was sent to you, or did you try to not read it? What was your thought process there when you were getting all those nasty messages and death threats and stuff like that?
Well, I totally missed the death threats. Fortunately, there were some Penn State fans that were on social media. It was in February of 2013 when we issued our reports, and I was on Mike and Mike. I did all the ESPN shows, went on Aaron Burnett's show and CNN, did all these shows. And people were just so angry that they felt like I was out there trying to protect the guy who covered up child sexual abuse, who enabled child sexual abuse. Now, that ball has moved in the media a long way. You know, when I go do interviews, the baseline with most reporters now is the free report is inaccurate and Joe didn't cover it up. That's the baseline now. Back then it wasn't. Back then it was he covered it up, Free got it all right, Free is the FBI director, completely credible, the whole nine yards. We know that it's completely not true now. But so some Penn State fans saw it and they alerted authorities about those. But I read a lot of the tweets and things because I wanted to have at least a feel for what we were dealing with in terms of trying to push this thing back. So yeah, I did read them, but you know, I wouldn't read them in real time. I'd wait a couple days and I'd go back and go through tweets or emails and things. I always make sure I was in a good place when I read them. I didn't want to be in a bad place and then read them, because then you run the risk of it. You know, as tough as you want to say you are, it'll get you. And you know, I know when Robin Williams died, his daughter dealt with some really nasty stuff. And I felt really bad because, you know, she's 23, 24 years old. I mean, at least I was in my 40s and, you know, should be able to handle that kind of stuff. But yeah, I did. And then, but because also in those things, you found some very, very beautiful things, which I put in the book too. There's some really great stuff. I mean, people can be so nice and so caring and literally pour their heart out to you. And then on the flip side, there are people that try and rip yours out. And I thought it was important that I show both those sides.
One last thing, Jay. As you know, when we've exchanged messages, I didn't go to Penn State, but another school with a lot of tradition. And one of the things as I was reading the book, I was learning more about your father than I'd previously known, some of which may be familiar to people who went to Penn State. But some of the things you talked about in terms of his coaching style, and there's a chapter on the Zen of Joe Paterno that I found sort of particularly interesting and moving. And as we wrap up, I'm just wondering if maybe you can talk a little bit about one of them, the blue line. I'm wondering if you can talk about that and just explain what it is and the philosophy behind that.
Actually, I was talking to a friend of mine as I was putting the book together. And this guy was raised Catholic and is still Catholic, but does, you know, read Zen Buddhism and stuff and things, talks about being in the moment and all those kind of things. Much like Phil Jackson is a big be-in-the-moment guy, you know, that kind of thing. And I said, you know, we had something similar to that. When you walked out of our locker room on the practice field, there was a blue line painted there. And when Joe would tell us, when you cross that blue line, you're mine. He said, when you cross that blue line, you can't do anything about the math test you may have done well on or failed. You can't do anything about the math the test you have tomorrow. You can't do anything about any problems you have with your girlfriend or if your father or mother is ill. You can't, it sounds, he said, you know, you can't do anything about that. The only thing you can do when you cross that blue line, you get better as a football player today and get better in understanding what we're doing. And you have to be totally locked into that. But then he would say, now look, when you walk off that field and you go into a classroom, you got to imagine there's a blue line in that classroom. And the only thing you can deal with in that classroom is what's right in front of you in that classroom. You have to listen, you have to pay attention, be focused. When you go home and you're with your family, you have to be totally locked in on your family. And he said to me, he goes, you know, I wasn't always, and I regret that. But he said, you have to put blue lines up all around everything you do. And you have to be able to really divide things up using these imaginary blue lines. And the guy said, you know, you need to write a chapter called The Zen of Joe Paterno, because that's totally Zen. And I go, well, I don't know what the hell Zen means, but it sounds good to me. So I sent him the chapter. He goes, yeah, you got it. But that was just what it was. Be in that moment. Cross that blue line. And there's, you know, every time I do something, I think about blue lines. Almost. And, you know, people have said to me, you know, are you mad at the university? I said, no. And in my mind, there's a blue line between the university I love and all the alums and all the students and the very small group of people who made decisions I disagree with. There's a blue line there. And if I ever cross the blue line on the side of them, it could get interesting. But, you know, if I'm ever in a room and there's a blue line there, it'll be very interesting. No, but I mean, you got to be able to do that. And I think that's how you succeed in anything in life, is you have to understand. You know, when my dad was fired, you know, I was very hesitant about finishing the season coaching. I talk about it in the book. But I understood I had a responsibility. And, you know, I was interviewed after the game by Tom Rinaldi, and he made asked about, you know, or not Tom Rinaldi, he was in the media room, and they said, how are we able to do this? I said, well, it goes back to how we were trained. We were all trained as a blue line. So regardless of the fact that my dad was fired, regardless of the fact that I'm not happy with some of the things and all such stuff going on, we crossed the blue line and only, you know, we can handle. And I think that's probably carried me in as good stead. Even writing this book, I had to cross that blue line and write about those moments.
Great words to close on. Let's thank Jay for coming out.